Good morning, everyone. As the hymn I just played said, Blessed Jesus, we are here at thy word to hear your word. So we welcome you here this morning if you are with us on site, and we welcome those of you who are watching us online as well. Pastor Sean is away this morning, and we're excited that our clerk of session, Elder Richard Boger, will be sharing our message with us this morning. Our worship band is here, and we'll have a great time together worshiping God this morning. I don't really have a lot of announcements, so I just want to refer you to our Beyond the Bulletin, refer you to the website, refer you to the Crestview app, and all of our schedules for the building and for the activities of Crestview are listed in those places, as well as the TV screens which are out here, so make sure you look at those. If you need any advice on a way to give a contribution, that's on those sites as well. And there's also an ability for you to send a text or communicate with us if you need to speak with any of us personally. You can do that through that. So make use of those wonderful resources this week. I want to read from Psalm 71 as we begin our worship this morning. This is a psalm that David wrote in his older life, and it's the psalm that catches our theme, sharing the good news. So let's prepare ourselves for worship. David says these words, I'm overflowing with your praise for all you've done. Your splendor thrills me all day long. I couldn't begin to count the times you've been there for me. And with the skill of a poet, I'll never run out of things to say about you, O Lord. I will come forth in your mighty strength. I'll tell everyone that you alone are the perfect one. From my childhood, you've been my teacher, and I'm telling everyone of your wonders. Give me grace to demonstrate to the next generation all of your mighty miracles, all of your excitement, to show them your magnificent power. For your glorious righteousness reaches up to the high heavens. No one could ever be compared to you. So, my loving God, the harp in my heart will praise you. Your faithful heart towards us will be the theme of my song. Melodies and music will rise to you, the Holy One of Israel. I will shout, I will sing your praises for all you are to me, Savior, lover of my soul. I'll never stop telling others how perfect you are. Lord, we worship you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. And Debbie is going to come and demonstrate we've been doing just what that scripture said.
Good morning. Boys and girls, come join me up here. All of you who are here, come on up front. We've got a couple of celebrations this morning, so I'm going to have you guys sit in the front row. Jason and Jane, you stay here with me. The rest of you sit up here. Here comes Bree. You come on up here, too. This morning, before we begin our VBS celebration, I would like to take a moment to recognize these two gentlemen. Jaden and Jason Tita were recently baptized at their parents' wedding, and since most of us in this room were not able to witness that day, we would like to celebrate you today. Jaden and Jason, being baptized is a very important milestone or a very important step in your journey to know and to love and to follow Jesus Christ in your lives. I want you to take a moment, see all these people here in this room, including me. We are all people who love you, and we promise to help you and support you as you go along and learn to be closer followers of Jesus Christ. And the really cool thing is that every single one of us in this room, we're working on our own journey to become closer followers of Jesus Christ. And so I think we're going to make a pretty great team together. Definitely. All right, so here I have your baptism certificates, Jason, and I have a small gift for each of you. Whoop, there's Jaden's. And in that bag is also your stone, so that when you look at that, you can remember this event in your life for years and years and years and years to come. Okay, definitely. All right. God bless you both as you grow in Him. I'm going to ask you two to sit here with your friends now. We have wrapped up another awesome week of VBS here at Crestview, and we just want to talk a little bit about that today, but really, the awesomeness started the day before VBS began, when you all showed up in droves to help us on setup day. You helped us set up the supplies, the stations, the decorations, and my co-directors here, Allie Boger and Allie Gary, we were able to wrap up our responsibilities that day at about 3:15 maybe, and head home. And that is by far the earliest we have ever wrapped up setup day in the 20-some years that I've been helping with this program. So we thank you for that. Because of all your helping hands, we were able to get home and show up Monday morning for the onslaught very well rested. So thank you for that. During the week, we had absolutely amazing volunteers who just showed up every morning, and they were full of energy and enthusiasm and love, and they just poured into our little ones every single day. And so those children who participated were just able to have the time of their lives that week, and they were really able to see God at work through the fabulous people who were leading them through their week. So to all those volunteers, we are very grateful. We were also blessed to have Tracy with us this week. Actually, she's been with us since day one of planning, and she was our fearless opening and closing leader through the week. So she was the one who helped us get the kids started off on the right foot each morning, and she was the one to help us send them out happy at the end of the day. Of course, she had a wonderful partner in crime in Cam Trax, a.k.a. Roddy Barber. And so I just told a secret. You knew it, didn't you? There was a debate all week long as to whether Cam Trax was really Rodney Barber or not, and now you know the secret, don't you? So we are very, very grateful for your support, too. If you were a volunteer during VBS, whether you donated supplies or you showed up for setup day or you stayed for takedown, anything in between, will you please stand right now? Mackenzie, that is you too. She's like, let's give them a huge thank you. Their hard work and dedication and tireless energy was just a blessing to each of us this week. And my co-directors, Allie and Allie, were tremendous blessings to me, and I thank you. Now, to give you a good look at what our week looked like and all the fun that we have, I would like you to sit back and relax and enjoy our presentation of our VBS 2021 fun. We'll have a seat.
We trust in you, Jesus. You're all, you're all, you're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope and life that's forever. You make us bold and we stand together. Journey, there's no looking back. With Jesus to lead us, we're on the right track. Oh, 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 oh. Wide open spaces for wide open eyes. We're looking ahead for the next. next big surprise. Oh, 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 oh. We trust, we trust, we trust in you, Jesus. You're all, you're all, you're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. You give us hope and life that's forever. You make us whole and we stand together. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting in you. We're off on this journey, there's no looking back. With Jesus to lead us, we're on the right track. Oh, oh. Spaces for wide open eyes. We're looking ahead for the next big surprise. Oh, 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 oh. We trust, we trust, we trust in you, Jesus. You're all that we need. Your power will pull us through. We're trusting in you, we're trusting.
Only did we adults have a great time at Vacation Bible School, but the kids really did as well. And we would like to share with you some of the wonderful quotes that we heard during Vacation Bible School.
One little boy asked his mother, "Is it almost dinner time? I want to go to bed so I can get back to VBS."
"My mom told me we would be here for 2 hours, but this feels like less than an hour."
This is another preschooler. "I want you to slow down VBS because it is over too fast. I also want VBS to do lunch."
Another little one said, "Why are the days so long? I just want to get back to VBS."
This was from a four-year-old. "Where can we get the VBS music? I looked all over iTunes and can't find it anywhere."
This was an actual conversation between myself and a child.
"Miss Tracy, why didn't we watch the video about the kid who does something special?"
"Well, I thought it would be good if we spent a lot of time on Jesus today."
"Oh yeah, you're probably right."
And this one melts my heart. When a little one was asked by a leader where they saw God, one boy said, "I saw God in you yesterday." Yeah, yeah. So, amazing week for us and an amazing week for the children. And again, we thank you so much for supporting us in this.
And Pastor Sean is very sorry that he wasn't here to give these to you, but he arose to the occasion. Thank you from
thank
our church
you.
And from all the boys and
thank
girls
you.
For all of your wonderful work during the week.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, boys and girls, we're going to go to class together. You come with us, Bree.
As the kids leave, we will again call ourselves to worship this morning. The word has come for us from God, who is good to all. His mercy is over all that he has made, as he promises to shelter us under the wings of hope and grace. And the word has come to us today from Jesus, who "I am the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus encourages us to remember the good news that we have received. And the word comes to us from the Spirit, the helper promised by Jesus, who indwells in his disciples being God in us as we testify to the reality of the gospel to the ends of the earth. The Holy Spirit who reminds us to place our hope and trust in God. I'll invite you to remain seated, and if you'd like to sing along with the band, please do.
Thank you guys very much for leading us. It was wonderful. Hello, everyone. As Rodney mentioned, my name is Richard Boger, and I'm your clerk of session, and I'm here sharing the message with you this morning. I'm really excited about this opportunity. So I did know that I was going to be covering for Sean for a couple weeks, He does actually, though. I did get a text from him this morning. There was one announcement that was missed, that there's actually 41 days until college football season starts. He wanted us to want to make sure I reminded you all of that. This morning, you know, the last few weeks, you know, we've been going through the book of Ephesians, and I've been paying especially close attention to the sermon the last few weeks, knowing I'm going to be kind of coming alongside this morning. If you recall, you know, that book was all about this, the last words of Paul to this group of believers in Ephesus. You know, remember, it was this kind of fairly large cosmopolitan city in the Roman Empire, and I thought for today we might rewind the story back a little bit to the beginning of that. You know, what was the message that that congregation heard in the first place that made them care what this guy Paul had to say? So we're going to talk a little bit about the good news. So the good news, the gospel is the word that we use to describe this message of Jesus. And as I kind of alluded to a second ago, it's a Greek word and it literally means good news. So good news, that's kind of an interesting phrase to use to define your message, right? You're defining it as good news. But I suppose by all accounts it was good news. If we just look at what happened, there was this movement of religious zealots kind of in the backwaters of the Roman Empire that, you know, moved into the urban centers and it caught fire and spread around. It was, from all accounts, a very appealing and inclusive and encouraging message. It was bringing in people from all sorts of ethnic backgrounds and beliefs. There were men and women that were leaders in the early church. It was crossing the class divide. There was, you know, slave and free, you know, rich and poor, all in communion around the same table. So by all accounts, I suppose it was good news, right? But really, what was the news? And might anyone today want to hear about it? Why might it be relevant to us today? So some of you might remember back in the early days of the COVID lockdowns. This was back when we were all totally hunkered down in our homes. One of the most popular viral videos that was going around was a video series on YouTube by the actor John Krasinski. He's the gentleman who plays Jim in the television show The Office. I know Russell Preston knows about them, the Prestons, right? it was a little series. It was called Some Good News, and you know, he shared these kind of heartwarming, feel-good stories of people helping each other out. Babies and first responders and frontline workers. You know, it was just some feel-good stories, and it got millions of views, which actually you might not know is even more than the numbers we get from the streaming service here at Crestview. So, good on you, John. Right? But it was just what people needed. It was a rough time, and they just wanted to hear some good news, right? So when we talk about the message of Jesus as good news, let's start with the part good. Well, if something is good, then I suppose that must mean that there's something that's bad. There must be some problem that this good news is addressing. And there is. It seems that in the world, there's this universal feeling we have about oughtness. And what I mean is that things ought to be a certain way, and conversely, the world's not the way it ought to be. You know, it's broken in some way. There's conflict. There's people that are exploited. There's this internal feeling, kind of this gap inside of us that, you know, we're really not the way we ought to be, and that there's something missing. And it's something that spans, I think, the whole universal experience. I mean, the churchgoer and the atheist both feel upset if they get beat up on the playground and have their lunch money stolen from them, right? There's something that's in us that tries to articulate this gap between, you know, what is and what should be. So really all of human history, you know, all of the religions and the social systems that we've developed have really been ultimately about this problem. How do we make the world closer to the way it ought to be? And although there, again, have been countless attempts to address this problem, most can be boiled down into one of two categories, which conveniently we can see right in the beginning in Genesis with the serpent in the garden. So now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Did God really say not to eat from any tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, we must not eat from the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. Oh, you will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So the first way that we've dealt with this gap between what is and what ought to be is actually just to kind of ignore it. As the serpent said, did God really say that? Did God really say that? Are there really any standards? Does it really matter? You know, and we can kind of veer to the extremes with this. You know, you can, do I really need to be worrying about this voice inside of me? Why don't I just take what I can get? You know, consume, you know, kind of live for my own self-gratification, you know, exploit people, get what I can get what's mine. Or kind of the other kind of angle, but it's kind of a similar motivation is, well, you know, I have this feeling inside of me, but I'm just going to, you know, it's not real. I'm going to ignore it. Life has no purpose. Life has no meaning. And you kind of get into that depressive, nihilistic angst, right? So the second, though, response we also see in the scripture is, you know, we see this gap, and we try to fill it with something that we do. You know, and there's multiple ways, I guess, as I said, you know, society, people have tried to fix this. You know, we seek knowledge. We try to seek experience. You know, the religions and philosophies of the world that have tried to enforce moral codes or walk you along some sort of path of enlightenment. You know, this is similar to this lure that we see kind of in the second part here, that by some action that we take or some knowledge that we attain, you know, eating some apple, something that we do, we can get this enlightenment and be like God. You know, we can finally get this understanding. Understanding of what? Well, knowing good and evil, right? Right and wrong, kind of this balance between what is and what ought to be. So, you know, we're kind of at the same problem. You know, this angst at our core, and we've got the two ways of dealing with it, right? The ignoring it way, which the procrastinators in the room probably will tell you doesn't usually work as a problem-solving technique, or the doing it ourselves way, which humanity has been working on for at least a couple thousand years, and let's say we still have some ways to go. But what if I told you there's some good news? There's not just two ways. There is actually another way. But we'll get back to that one in a second. Okay, so for this next part, I want to put in a little disclaimer. I've never actually met this person, so anything that I say is kind of what I've read about him. But from what I can tell, there is probably a pretty convincing case that he was a disorganized, disgusting slob. So the person I'm talking about was a biological researcher in the UK, in England, and he studied molds and bacteria, which I apologize to any biologists in the room, I feel is just kind of disgusting just to start out with, right? But it wasn't so much that he just would study them. You know, he really loved mold. And he was an amateur painter, and he would actually take these bacterias and slimes from the lab, because some of them would have maybe interesting pigments, and he would use them to, in lieu of his watercolors, and paint them on the canvas, which I suppose you could say that would help bring his paintings to life, I guess. But yeah, so he was kind of a little quirky guy, but you know, he was good in his career. There were a couple things he was pretty notable for. He had actually identified, the first person to identify some of the enzymes in nose, in your tears, and mucus, which you just know that he would collect the samples, you know, himself, right? You just knew that that's the way he was. But the thing he's most famous for was the discovery of something he referred to as mold juice. So, did anyone have mold juice for breakfast this morning? And the way he discovered mold juice is he actually went on vacation for 2 weeks, and he left all his stuff in the sink. And when he got back, there was this like sludge of stuff in the sink that he called mold juice. He was kind of disgusting, I said, but he was also pretty observant. And he noticed that mold juice was killing the staph bacteria that was also in the sink. So this guy's name was Alexander Fleming, and the mold juice that he discovered that morning was penicillin. So he later reflected on that morning. He said, when I woke up just after dawn on September 28th, 1928, I certainly didn't plan to revolutionize all medicine by discovering the world's first antibiotic or bacteria killer, but I guess that was exactly what I did. And the world was forever different. For the first time in human history, We had an effective defense against bacterial infection. There are some days in history that just change everything, right? 9/11, Pearl Harbor, you know, the day we discovered penicillin. Things were one way one day and then different the next. And when we think about the early church sharing the good news, it was that news that they were sharing. It was an account of one of these types of events. John Gresham Machen was a Presbyterian and New Testament scholar early in the last century. And he has a quote that I think makes this observation and sums it up, this good news, perfectly. So, from the beginning, the Christian gospel, as indeed the name gospel or good news implies, consisted of an account of something that happened. The great weapon with which the disciples of Jesus set out to conquer the world was not a mere comprehension of eternal principles, it was a historical message, an account of something that had recently happened. It was the message, "He is risen." There was an event. They were there, and they witnessed it, and they wanted to share the good news. And what was the news? The news was that this God, who created the universe and humanity, and desires to have this relationship with us, that same God, even after we rebelled, creating this gap between where we were and where we ought to be, loved us so much that he came to earth in the form of his son, Jesus, and through the death and resurrection has filled that gap, closed the gap that we can never fully ignore and never completely close ourselves. It's the arrival and the work of Jesus, that event that changed the world. Just like the one day we didn't have penicillin and the next day we did, before Jesus we had no cure for our separation from God, and after he came, we did. And that's why the news is good, right? We know that God knows about the brokenness we feel inside of us. We know God knows about the brokenness of the world, and he has made the moves to fix it and put the world back in the course where it ought to be. So we need not despair. We need not be overly anxious. We need not worry about our efforts to fix things and that they're not working. You know, we need not worry that we aren't good enough, because of course we aren't. That's why God had to step in. So of course, when we hear this good news and we accept the gift and begin to appreciate what God's provided, it's naturally going to affect how we see the world and the people around us. And it may lead us to want to, gain more knowledge about this God. It may lead us to develop philosophies of how we live. It may lead us to form social systems and work for justice in the world and make different social contributions. But we need to remember what's the cause and what's the effect, right? All these things we do are just responses. Jesus is the one who closed the gap, and it's his historical work that is the good news. So how do we respond to this? How do we communicate this to our rich multicultural world around us? You know, I have friends that aren't Christian that I care for and I love. You know, what's to become of them? What do I do? So this morning, I'd recommend that we approach communicating the gospel in three ways: with conviction, with perspective, and with urgency. So my first recommendation is that when you share the good news, do it with conviction. That doesn't mean with arrogance. It doesn't mean that you can't share your own struggles and uncertainties with the message. What I'm cautioning is against distorting the gospel in an effort to try to fit in with the culture. You know, a few weeks ago, Sean used a quote, usually attributed to St. Augustine, "In essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; in all things, charity." And I totally agree with the sentiment of that message. You know, we need to be charitable to those people that are around us. But we also need to remember the beginning, and we not forget that there are some things about the gospel that are essential. Now, I've only ever lived in contemporary American culture, so I don't know if this is universal or just a product of our age, but I'm shocked by how we as a culture seemingly have no problems blindly accepting contradictions. We'll bend over backwards saying that all viewpoints are equivalent, as if in some way Jesus can somehow both be and not be the Son of God at the same time. What it really means, I think, is that we're not talking about the same thing with people. Sure, Jesus might be one of many great moral teachers, but remember a few minutes ago, the gospel wasn't a moral teaching. On the Saturday after Good Friday, you know, the day before Easter, the disciples had all of Jesus' moral teaching. And what were they doing? They were huddled up, hiding in a room. It wasn't until the event of the resurrection and the Holy Spirit coming upon them at Pentecost where they went out and they changed the world, right? And either that event happened or it didn't. And really, it doesn't do anyone any good to water it down somehow in an attempt to make it more palpable in some way, right? Matthew 15, during the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus addresses this. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. Ultimately, truth matters, and the farther you get away from the truth, the less it matters. Paul speaks to the dangers also of watering down this amazing message of good news in his first letter to the Corinthians. So this is a little bit long. This is a paraphrase from the message, but I think it's worthwhile going through. So, now let me ask you something profound yet troubling. If you became believers because you trusted the proclamation that Christ is alive, risen from the dead, how can you let people say there is no such thing as a resurrection? If there's no resurrection, then there's no living Christ. And face it, if there's no resurrection for Christ, everything we've told you is smoke and mirrors, and everything you've staked your life on is smoke and mirrors. Not only that, but we would be guilty of telling a string of bald-faced lies about God. All these affidavits that we passed on to you verifying that God raised up Christ, sheer fabrications if there's no resurrection. If corpses can't be raised, then Christ wasn't, because he was indeed dead. And if Christ weren't raised, then all you're doing is wandering about in the dark, as lost as ever. It's even worse for those who died hoping in Christ and resurrection, because they're already in their graves. If all we get out of Christ is a little inspiration for a few short years, we're a pretty sorry lot. But the truth is that Christ has been raised up, the first in a long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. We're truly blessed, everyone, that we live in a tolerant multicultural society where people can freely exchange ideas and have disagreements and still live in peace as neighbors. But that doesn't mean that we distort the good news into something less than it is so we fit in. We need to have conviction. So at this point, though, I have to be a little bit careful because I probably don't have time for a cute story about YouTubers or biologists playing with boogers, because after that last section, I bet maybe a few people in the room and perhaps some people online are starting to think to themselves, wow, this guy's starting to show his true colors a little bit. He's probably one of those fundamentalist kind of guys that really kind of gives the rest of us Christians a bad name. Doesn't he know that God loves everyone? Christians like him make the gospel seem so exclusionary, right? And I want to spend some time on this topic, because the accusation that the gospel is exclusionary and somehow that its adherents are in some way intolerant is such a huge objection that we in the modern church have to deal with. I think it's our biggest one. In this world of social shaming and the internet is forever, when you're on camera and there's even a hint that you might be, you know, classified as being intolerant, you want to, you know, do something drastic like immediately talk about Nobel Prize winners playing with boogers, right? You want to lighten the mood. So ultimately, though, we can't escape this charge exclusivity because Jesus himself makes it, right? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, right? Jesus said it. However, I think the key to addressing this issue is my second recommendation on how we approach the gospel, and that is with perspective. And when I say we should approach the gospel with perspective, I mean we should have a proper perspective about who God is and a proper perspective about who we are. So a couple years ago, Allie and I were teaching a Sunday school class with the fifth and sixth graders, which is always a joy because, you know, aren't our Crestview kids so clever, right? They're wonderful. And anyway, as part of the lesson, We were pondering together the question, where is God? And one of the students made the observation that God is everywhere, so he sees all perspectives. And I think that's a great thing to think about when we consider God's response to the world, including all the billions of people that are not attending a Christian service this Sunday. You love and care for the well-being of your Christian friends and neighbors. Well, one thing I can tell you for certain is that God is infinitely more holy, compassionate, and just than you will ever hope to be. And that neighbor that you say you love, Christ died for him. So let's set that perspective right up front. Scripture is clear that God loves and cares for all his creation. Psalm 145, the Lord is good to all, and his mercies are over all his works. Jesus came to restore all, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for everyone, from the book of Titus. 2 Peter, Peter is responding to people that are asking, you know, why isn't Jesus back yet? You know, what's taking him so long to come back? And his response is, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. So, I mean, we need to have perspective. When we say we have good news, we have really good news. The work of Jesus we've been talking about is actually the least exclusionary message in the history of the world. Jesus died for you. He did it. He doesn't have to keep redoing it over and over for different ages and different cultures. The work is done. Penicillin has been found. The cure is here. You don't need another prophet. You don't need another sacrifice. You don't need another social system. You don't need to walk on another pilgrimage. You don't need another path of enlightenment. All you need to do is to accept the gift already given for you. So we also, I said, we need perspective of ourselves in all of this. When we're speaking about the gospel, we're not implying that we are in some way morally superior to others, nor are we the ones that are doing the work to provide the salvation or kind of the gatekeepers of Christ's message. We didn't save ourselves by our works, so there's no possible way we can be in charge of saving someone else, being the, you know, the one judging with that criteria. You know, in the Ephesians that we just talked about, Paul says, "For it's by grace you have been saved through faith." And this is not from yourself. It's a gift from God, not by your works, so that no one can boast. When we face the accusation that Christians are somehow exclusionary, our response, I think, should be absolutely not. There's nothing special or remarkable about us as people, as Christians. But oh boy, let me tell you about my Jesus. The third recommendation that I have of how we should approach the gospel is to approach it with urgency. So let's go back again and reconsider the billions of people that I mentioned a few minutes ago on earth right now that aren't in church with us here today. If we're not just giving lip service to the fact that we care about them and we love them, then what are we going to do, and when are we going to get around to doing it? You know, Jesus reminds us, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Paul asks us, how then can they call on one that they've not believed in? And how can they believe in one whom they've not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? You know, I volunteered to fill in here for Sean, and you sit down, you start putting together something, and you naively pick something as hugely significant as the gospel, and you start putting together your notes, and you get to this page at the end where, like, this is the glaring question. What do we do about it, right? And I start to sit there, and I kind of start scratching my head, and I'm like, well, geez, it would be nice if I had some advice on this, someone that's maybe done this a little bit more than me, you know. Perhaps someone that's kind of gone through some trials, you know, maybe someone that, it'd be great if you could go back in time and talk to the people that were doing it. You know, wouldn't it be awesome if you could talk to, you know, Peter, who kind of was charged with taking that group, you know, huddled in the room and going out and spreading the gospel. And then you suddenly realize, oh, yeah, I have it right here in the book of 2 Peter, or 1 Peter right here. So here in the scripture, if you think, it's crazy to think about it. We've got these people's words with us right here today. So Peter says in 1 Peter 13 through 15, it's this advice to us. Who is going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what's right, you're blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord, and always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. So Peter does a lot of the stuff, addresses a lot of the stuff we talked about. I think he talks about this attitude that we should have, this attitude of humility, this attitude to hold Christ in our hearts. But he also gives us a task. And that's the task that we should always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for your hope. We need to be able to articulate the gospel to other people. Now that can sound super daunting, right? You may think you don't know enough, but I'll suggest that you only need to teach or tell people three things. And you can use whatever words that you're most comfortable with, but there are three things which happen to be the things that we've been talking about this morning. You need to be able to communicate the nature and character of God. You need to be able to communicate the condition of humanity and the work of Jesus. So the first one, the nature and character of God. You know, we believe that God created us as part of a perfect creation, and this God loves and desires a relationship with us. You know, I think in our times this can probably be the hardest step, but there are completely logical and consistent arguments for the existence of God. And, you know, if you want to talk with me about that or talk to someone else about that, I know our adult education team has a study in the month of August about communicating about the nature of God and the existence of God. Be comfortable, because ultimately, who saves us? God saves us. So we need to be able to communicate that. The second, the condition of humanity. You know, this is the problem, right, that Christ addresses, that because of our rebellion and wanting to do things our own way, we've become estranged from God. And things just aren't the way it ought to be, right? We feel unsettled. The world has brokenness. And no matter how hard we try to seem to fix the world, we just can't get it done ourselves. And third, the work of Jesus. But because God loved the world so much, he came to earth in the form of Jesus to forever close the gap, repair the damage. And all that's needed from us is to accept the gift that was given and begin our new life in communion with God. That's it. That's the good news. It's a simple, straightforward message that anyone can deliver. You'll spend your whole life trying to grasp the significance of it, but it has eternal importance. And we need not be worried too much because the Holy Spirit is there to help guide us along this path. Friends, we've been given the amazing opportunity to share the good news from the God that created the universe to the entire world. The prophet Isaiah recounted a similar opportunity that came to him. And he says, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?' And then I said, 'Here I am. Send me.'" What a responsibility, but what an honor and a privilege. Thanks be to God for that opportunity. Amen.
This morning we'll continue with our congregational prayers. Richard referred to a couple of verses from 1 Peter 3, and I'm going to use some other verses from that as our prayers this morning begin with helping us to achieve a boldness and a confidence as we share this good news. So let's pray together. Lord, as we take a deep breath and relax into your presence, help us to apply your gentle spirit of compassion and humility and love into our lives so that we might be examples of godly believers and give glory to your holy name. Lord, from 1 Peter 3:9, may we walk in spirit and truth. Help us to do all that you have called us to do in the power of the Holy Spirit, for you have promised that your grace is sufficient for all the eventualities of life. Lord, we thank you for our lives and pray through our actions and our attitudes that we will become a real encouragement to others. And loving Father, day by day, help us to grow in grace and in knowledge of the Lord Jesus. For in searching for Him, the Prince of Peace, we know that we will find and we will keep His perfect peace in our hearts and have the power to share that with whomever You would direct us to do so. Lord, today we also pray for members of our congregation. First, Lord, for Letha Howell, for comfort in the recent passing of her sister, Joyce. Lord, for Olive Morse, who will be moving to North Carolina soon. Lord, for Donna and Ray Bowman, celebrating an anniversary. From our prayer list, Lord, for Dina and for two friends of Tracy Long, for Holly and pain management, and for the recent passing of Jim Richardson and his family. Lord, help us to take just a second now. I'm sure there are other names on our hearts, Lord. Help us to lift those folks up to You right now. Lord, thanks for hearing each of our prayers. Thank You that we have been redeemed by the blood of Christ and that our desire is to be fully made holy unto Him. Our bodies, sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. This week, Lord, guard our hearts and guide our speech. Give us wisdom to be able to give an answer for the hope that is in us, and to give a defense for our trust in Christ and the blessed hope that we have in Him. And Lord, we pray through the power of Your Holy Spirit, we would be able to answer to anyone, to everyone who asks us about our faith in Christ, in gentleness, in reverence, all for Your praise and Your glory. We pray these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. If you are able and would like, I'll invite you to stand for our final song this morning.
Suffering I do drink, of its work I do sing, for on it my Savior both bruised and crushed showed that God is love and God is just. Cross You beckon me, You draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly under Your wrath.
beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, holy surrender at the cross. You beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I am sweetly broken, holy surrender.
So as we leave this morning, let's again remember the advice that Peter gave. Who's going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what's right, you're blessed. Do not fear your threats, their threats. Don't be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord, and always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. Go in peace and spread the good news. Amen.
Restless gift, undeserved life, and I've given Christ crucified. Oh, you've called me out of death. You've called me into life. And I was under your wrath. Now through the cross I'm reconciled. Gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm really broken, holy surrender. All of the cross I must confess. How wondrous your redeeming love, and how great your faithfulness. You beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, holy surrender at the cross. You beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees.
together.